刚才健身博士问的问题呢，我是可以跟大家归纳性的总结，有几个问题来给大家回答。第一个呢，我认为藏传佛教它具有一个比较完整性，因为佛教现在信仰佛教的人，就中国大陆也好，还有全世界的各个地方的年轻人呢越来越多，因为藏传佛教当中，它有一个南传佛教、北传佛教，包括日本和汉地兴盛的，还有台南和缅甸等兴盛的南传佛教。其实南传佛教和北传佛教的所有的这些经典论点的教义，包括一些戒律和修法呢，都可以在藏传佛教里面笼罩得到的。而且可以满足，他的信众，而其他的，包括南传佛教里面不一定照得到北传佛教和藏传佛教的教义，北传佛教里面呢也不一定能照得到藏传佛教，和南传佛教的个别教义。所以说呢，我认为现在我们的信仰佛教的很多人呢，他是具有一种多样文化的，也就是说。他的信仰是有各种各样的，要满足他的话呢，要需要有一种多样文化的思想在里面才可以让接受。就所以第一个呢，应该说这个藏传佛教呢就非常完整的。也许你们可能有些人不一定很相信，但我希望你们可以看看就我们藏传佛教的大藏经里面有显宗和密宗。有108汉，然后轮主当中印度的轮主就是我们说的轮主，213汉，213册，还有藏地高僧他们所做的每一个人的作品呢，那非常非常多的。所以，如果我们真的去研究藏传佛教的时候呢，你可能会很惊讶的发现，就这里面所有的佛教的包罗万象的思想都。无不包括。
So to summarize this, I want to answer this question in a summarized way. The first feature that I think Tibetan Buddhism has is its completeness. What does that mean? In Tibetan Buddhism, you can find scriptures or theories also in Theravada Buddhism and Mahayana Buddhism. Theravada Buddhism, as some of you may know, it's very popular in Thailand, Burma, in those countries. And for Mahayana Buddhism, it's very popular in China, Japan, and other countries. But if you want to find the theories in Theravada or Mahayana Buddhism, you can find them in Tibetan Buddhism also. But if you want to find something from Theravada Buddhism in Mahayana Buddhism, you may not find them. But if you want, and also if you want to find theories in Mahayana Buddhism, in Theravada Buddhism, you may not be able to find. However, in Tibetan Buddhism, you can find all the aspects of Buddhism there. And especially for, not especially, for example, like discipline and the practice methods, all of those things you can find in Tibetan Buddhism. And what another thing is, in Tibetan Buddhism, you can find it's because it's very diverse, everything is in there. So Tibetan Buddhism can satisfy the curiosity of people in different background with different knowledge. And different people wants to get the answers for different questions, they can find their answers in Tibetan Buddhism. And in Tibetan Buddhism, we have the Sutrayana and Mantrayana. And for Sutrayana, you can find there are 108 sutras and also 213 commentaries, as well as other works by Tibetan great masters. And all of these sutras, commentaries, and works by great masters all these scriptures, if you get a chance to look at them, you will find it's very inconceivable. It's a lot of knowledge in there.
这是第一个。第二一个，应该藏传佛教具有非常强的逻辑性。现在城市里面的人呢，都可能会怀疑，疑惑比较多，思想很纷乱，很多问题就依靠宗教来解决。但是宗教来解决的话，个别的宗教呢，它只是依靠一种信仰，并没有自己的给你从理论上、从道理上说得非常清楚。而藏传佛教，他的移民，昨天我跟博士，也谈到，他也曾经在藏传佛教当中学过很多移民。其实，这种辩论法，辩论法是，完全符合现在我们国际的一些大学的这种辩论思想。也就是说，你有什么样的疑问，你有什么样的看法，觉得对方的观点不合理的话，你可以开诚布公的驳斥推翻。那么这个是在其他的一些宗教和佛教当中很难的。所以在藏传佛教里面，占很长时间的这种空间呢，就学习一些非常有理的这种辩论，默念自己的思想。那么这种思想呢，特别适合现在很多年轻人，尤其是城市里面疑惑比较大的时候呢，你可以把你的问题带到寺院里面，带到上师那里就进行辩论。如果你辩不赢的话，那你可以跟他学；你如果辩得赢的话，那不学也可以，完全可以推翻。这样的一种很开放的思想呢，如今这个时代当中非常跟得上，就是21世纪。
So just now that was the first one. The second one, I think Tibetan Buddhism has is the logicality. What does that mean? For a lot of people in cities or urban people, we have a lot of doubts and confusion. And some people will rely on religion to solve those problems. However, a lot of religion can only help you in a way that depends on your faith, your devotion. You have to believe in something. But for Buddhism, we have Buddhist logic, which is Pramanavada. And in that, you can have debate with other people, with other Buddhists or great masters. And this kind of idea really fit in the education as in universities.Because when you find something that you cannot accept at first sight, then you can debate or discuss it with other people openly. And at the same time, if you really don't think that's something you can accept, or if you think it's not logic, you can refute it. This you cannot find in most of the other religions.And if you study debate, that kind of skill, you can sharpen your own thinking. And I think this is also something attract urban young people. And when you have questions, confusion, doubts, you can go to a monastery. You can find a master, you can debate with him. And if you win, you can refuse his theories or any Buddhist theories.But if you fail, then you can start from this master or from Indian monastery.
你们当中如果有辩论的话呢，这个博士呢，他也学过很长时间的移民。我也是年轻的时候学过移民和辩论。就是待会儿问问题的时候呢，你们就不用考虑，就是可以辩论。
So, if ever you want to debate or you want to do that kind of thing.Dr. Jensen, she studied Buddhist logic for a long time. And myself, when I was young, I also studied Buddhist logic. You can try it.
这是我说的它的逻辑性，还有一个叫做是系统性。藏传佛教应该有个很完整的系统性，从我们基本的一个基础知识，然后一步一步的它的理论它的修行都次第很完整。比如说藏传佛教先有就加兴开始，然后有五部大论的隐敏啊、戒律啊、中观啊、般若啊、还有俱舍论啊，还有密宗的一些次第啊。所以这种次第呢特别符合现在我们实践的一些从小学、中学还有这个高中，不知道河南有没有高中，还有大学，一直到研究生和博士生，就是这样的这种次第。而且这个次第呢比如说对我们佛学院拿荣盖而言的话呢那么就是从这个佛学的基础知识到最后毕业呢需要15年的时间。我们现在一般的普通的一个学年呢就是15年的时间。在这个15年的时间上面呢你就可以再创造就是大法师啊，就这样。所以我觉得这种系统方法呢就是如今在很多的可能在其他的这个佛教当中比较罕见。
And so the third one, I think that Tibetan Buddhism has it's very systematic. Why I say that is because in Tibetan Buddhism, we have very basic studies, and then stage by stage, then you get a very profound or advanced practice or study in that.For example, we have the preliminary practices for Tibetan Buddhist practitioners and followers or anyone who wants to study Tibetan Buddhism. And also, we have the 5 Mahayana treatises that you can study, which is the Middle Way, the Pratipada, and also Abhidharma, and Pranavada, just as the Buddhist logic.And this is kind of just like we have in the secret world, we have elementary school, middle school, high school, and universities, and also master or PhD programs. So it's kind of like parallel in the same way. And people just ask, do you have a high school in Holland or not? And also in Narangar, we have the...standard education from very basic level to very advanced level. For a student to graduate, it takes 15 years. And after 15 years study, you can get a Kenpo degree after that.
还有藏传佛教有一种科学性，因为现在的人们虽然科学并不是能解决所有的问题，但是呢很信仰，很有权威性，全世界的人们都觉得不是科学的人也认为是这是科学的。但的确有些上面呢藏传佛教我认为是有科学的。比如说藏传佛教的有个天文学。天文学是什么样呢怎么讲啊，它是相当于是有在理算一年当中的，比如说日历的话他用一块木板，然后这个木板上藏传一般传统的上面告一些白色的灰，然后灰上面就可以再进行预算，不需要其他的包括一些电脑啊就其他任何的科学仪器。我们那边有一个天文学的研究者，他是有一次在中国社会科学院天文系的这些教授一起研究的时候，他拉着传统的这个木块去预算的时候，刚开始他们都看不起他，讥笑他，就是说是你这样的传统很落后的。后来他们在预算过程当中比电脑还快，就这些人就人还活着的，而且 现在我们拉荣根里面也有一部分堪布，他们也是完全用这种方式来算。算的话，那整个我们的拉荣日历，拉荣日历的话，那现在在藏地也是很出名的。那么这个呢，就是通过几个堪布的就短短的时间当中，就是去预算，预算之后呢，就算出来了，不需要什么其他的，包括360天的这个。这个闰月啊，就日时啊、月时啊，当当，全是跟现在天文台算的一模一样的。关于这方面，有一些还有一些木块，就是那个木条，就是插在地上，就是不管是你到那个地方，都可以根据这个太阳的影子跟他们下面的记号可以运算。这个是我的老师。金美彭措法王的他的著作当中也有，我们以前去试验过，我们书上的书表里面的这种分数跟这里面的这个预算的话，那非常非常相同，所以这些也许你们不信，就是不信也没事，但是我希望你们去研究很有必要的。在这样的话，光从天文学呢，确实是有很多殊胜之处。
The fourth one is it's very scientific. Although we know that science cannot solve all our problems, but nowadays people think science is the authority. And the example that I want to give you in Tibetan Buddhism about its the feature that it's very scientific is about astronomy. Because in Tibetan Buddhism,we have a skill which is the calendar calculation. So traditionally, people, the Tibetan scholars, they will use a plate, and on the plate, they will put white ashes cinder on it, and then they will just calculate on this plate, and use the formula that they memorized.Without any computer or instruments or devices, just do it, use your head. And one of the examples that I want to give you is one of the Buddhist scholars which is good at calendar calculation. Once he was invited to the China Academy of Social Sciences, and there are some experts.They are doing the calendar calculation there. And so those experts, at first, they look down on him because he's using very antique, very out-of-date stuff doing the calculation, sophisticated calculation. But when his result came out, they were kind of surprised because the result he has is the same as what they have.When they are using computers, a lot of things, instruments, everything, but the results are the same. And he did this quicker than all their machines. So then they look up to him after that. This is one thing. And also, this same calculation skill also exists in Larangor.In Largo, we have some temples, they can do this calendar calculation too. Then you can have the accurate time for the moon and the solar and lunar eclipses, and also the time for leap months. It's very accurate. And the Largo calendar is very popular in Tibetan area. And at the same time, we also have some skills, which is you can use a stick, like chopstick,You put it on the ground and then use the shadow of it and the marks on the stick. You can find the time, exact time. And that is very accurate. You can just compare your watch and what you can calculate from that stick. And this is collected in my teacher's work, Jimmy Pinchon, which is collective work. You can find that part in his collective work. And you may think this is something unbelievable. You may not believe in this, but it's fine you don't believe this. You can, but what I want to say is you can study it, try to find it, see if it's true or not.
其实我今天藏传佛教的功德 好像在宣传一样，但是我并不是，像这样这些，因为这些事也不重要，实际上是一个事实。但是你们让我讲一些他的信念的话，我的确也认为是他有很多方面的这种力量。
So today, so far it sounds like I'm advertising Tibetan Buddhism, but that's not my usual intention. It's because you already asked me to answer this question. But I think what everything that I have told you so far are all facts. I'm not lying or something like that.
还有一个，这个佛教。藏传佛教里面有一个他的心理科学，他的心理科学以前我看过兰斯老布的一个叫做是摩安坎林，他是专门研究心理学，他造了一个叫荣格语藏传佛教的这个心理科学。那么这本书里面都讲了东西方的这个心理科学的相同和不同点，那最后就讲到荣格呢，把这样的心理科学当作为自我的一种发现，自我的完整和就成就，而藏传佛教呢，把佛性最后就能圆满的得到这个究竟，利益众生。所以通过他的一些分析的话呢，实际上的确这个心理科学啊。因为大家都知道心理学虽然在西方哲学里面也有而整个现在的这个心理科学是不到100年，就是这样的心理学是不到100年。可是在真正的藏传佛教的这种心理科学呢早已成熟啊，早已成熟。那么这个呢可以从莲花生大师的很多教研里面就完全可以看出，因此他能解决现在很多心理上的，包括一些抑郁症啊、自闭症啊，就包括心理的很多问题呢，通过修心，就是藏传的秘法，就是后来获得这个释放啊。我接触的很多很多的东西方的佛教徒当中呢，都是以前是特别痛苦的，就是心里很。我听说你们河南也是，有些人说因为天气的原因，冬天很长时间没有太阳。所以就心里出一些问题，但我觉得可能不是天气的原因，因为现在人们的这种各种非常复杂的思想引起的，像这些问题呢，应该很多都可以在有一些心理的这种调整方法来解决。
And the secret example about because I said it's very scientific.And the second example I want to give you is psychology. I read a book by the author's name is Moa Canning, and the book is called Jung's Psychology and Tibetan Buddhism. And it did the comparison between Tibetan Buddhism and psychology. And Jung said something like the psychologyIt's the study of the self-realization and growth of consciousness and also the spiritual transformation. And for Tibetan Buddhism, we see the ultimate Buddha nature and also when we realize that we can do things that can benefit sentient beings. And there are some common points there and also some differences. And for psychology, it's less than 100 years of its history. But for Tibetan Buddhism, the aspect of psychology is more than 2,000 years. And you can find these ideas and the theories about this in Padmasambhava's instructions in those books. And that is, you can find similar things as in psychology. And so I think it's very good method for Tibetan Buddhism to solve a lot of mental problems, mental diseases, such as depression, autism. And through tantra practice, we can really cure those mental sufferings. And I heard that people here in Holland have some kind of depression or something like that, and they said the reason is because of the weather or the climate, because the daylight time is very short. That's why they get depression. But I don't think that's the reason. I think it's because our mental health, our mental events, activities, we think too much. We have very complex thinking. That's why we get those mental problems.